Welcome back. As we promised our dear viewers that our very first segment of the breakfast show, we are going to discuss a very important topic, which is the Renaissance Dam, and to be considered as a national security issue. Our Egyptian share of the Nile water, it's something unnegotiable. What are going to be the impacts of the Renaissance Dam? What should be the preparations ahead of the coming tripartite summit, which is going together the ministers of Sudan, Ethiopia, and Egypt? Why it was postponed? What's on the agenda of this meeting? All these things and more, we are very much delighted to discuss with our dear guest live here in the studio, Dr. Mohamed Abdel Aati, former chairman of the Nile Water Sector of the Ministry of Water Resources and Irrigation. Thank you very much for being with us, sir, and have a very good morning.
This is my pleasure.
Good morning, Dr. Abdel Aati. And of course, regarding the Renaissance Dam issue and its effect on downstream countries and the upcoming very important meeting that will be held in Khartoum between the three countries, Egypt, Ethiopia, and Sudan, what are the most important topics that will be tackled during this meeting? And how do you see the performance or the attitude of Ethiopia towards the postponing of negotiations several times?
Yes, actually, this is multiple questions in one question. So concerning this next meeting, as we know that there was several obstacles and postponing of the technical or recruiting the international firm to do the two missing studies.
Mm-hmm. It's taking too long to choose the consultancy
because
firms.
Actually,
and meanwhile, they are proceeding with the construction of the dam.
Actually, yeah. As we remember, the let's go back a little bit during the how this committee was
formed.
Yes. During the visit of Dr. Sam Sharaf, former Prime Minister, to Ethiopia, he agreed with former or passed away Prime Minister Meles Zenawi to have a tripartite international panel of experts, because Ethiopia was claiming that the studies of the Renaissance Dam are complete. Egypt was saying that it is incomplete. Then the conclusion of this committee said that no, the studies are not complete, and there are two missing major studies. Mm-hmm. Two major studies are missing. The first one is the impact on the downstream countries. The second one is the socio-economic impact of the dam. Mm-hmm. Then the second committee have been formed, and the countries agree that this committee will recruit an international firm. The issue here, or the mistake here, that they followed the classical way of recruitment of international firm. Mm-hmm. It was not a direct order recruitment, but they followed the bidding normal or classical bidding procedure as if we are doing, an urgent matter.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Finally, they agree that there are two qualified firms, the BRL from France and the Paris, yes, from Netherlands. Mm-hmm. And they divided the work between both of them, 70-30, yes. But the BRL, the main contractor, put some constraints on the Netherlands firm that we will not, you have to follow what we tell you to do.
Right.
This was not accepted by the Dutch firm, and the issue have been raised. Several trials have been done to resume or resolve. To resolve this issue, but unfortunately it failed.
They didn't reach middle ground.
And the initial plan was to finish these studies last March. So now we are delayed and we didn't start yet.
And meanwhile, they're proceeding with the construction of the dam. They reached around 50% of
the construction. It is almost 50%. Mm-hmm. But I would like to mention that this is not the only dam that is under construction. Mm-hmm. There are several planned dams to be constructed.
All in Ethiopia?
All in Ethiopia, on the Blue Nile, upstream the Renaissance Dam. Mm-hmm. It was initially another three dams, but the new studies say that it is another six dams.
Seven, including the Renaissance,
it will be seven. In addition to that, there are other dams have been constructed over the past 15 years.
Right.
Like Shara Sharawir, Tanna Balas, Tikezi. And then with the agreement of Sudan, with Sudan, they constructed the Marawi Dam and raised the Rosaires Dam. So right. There are several, and Bugajarin in Uganda. So there are several dams that have been constructed over the past 15 years, and there are planned dams in the future. So we need to consider that. We need to resolve the issue. So I expect that the next meeting, it will include...
This was my coming question, yes, sir, regarding those dams or the issue of the Nile River states in general. We are all the time speaking about the tripartite summit between or among Ethiopia, Sudan, and Egypt. I don't know if this is applicable or no. Don't you think that we also need to have broader meetings or broader summits to include many of the Nile states basin countries, the Nile basin states?
Actually, this is another step, but the next step, the broader summit that will be held, because actually the technical studies time, I consider that it is passed away. So the next meeting will include the ministers of foreign affairs, in addition to the ministers of
already
water resources.
Already in the Africa-China summit, which took place recently in Johannesburg in South Africa, among the high-ranking official members was our top diplomat, His Excellency Minister Sameh Fahmy, and he met with Tewodros Adhanom, his Ethiopian counterpart. And I think that one of the priorities on the agenda of talks was the Renaissance Dam, just ahead of the tripartite summit, which my dear colleague Naveen said it's going to take place, inshallah, in just a few days in Khartoum.
Hopefully, because this is not the first postponement.
It's not confirmed yet.
No, it is. They claim that it is around next week or postponed a week.
Yes,
but I hope that it will be the last postponing, because there was several postponing of the meetings several times. My worry is that if we are not able to conduct the meeting during 11 and 12, I think, of December, I think it will not be held before 7th of January, because you are approaching Christmas time in Europe, 25th of December, and 7th of January, it is Christmas.
Meaning at least 3 more weeks.
So hopefully that, let's be optimistic and assume that it will happen and the meeting will be held. Actually, the focus will be to bring into action or to apply what have been agreed between the three presidents of Egypt, Ethiopia, and Sudan on the framework of cooperation. And now there is a sort of breach of this framework, because we didn't tie with the set time schedule to finalize the studies last March.
Right, sir. What if the studies or the reports by the consultancy firms shows that the dam will be harmful to downstream countries? And Ethiopia mentioned that the recommendations of the consultancy firm will not be binding. So what will be the situation in that case? Is it the best solution is to internationalize the issue? What are the different scenarios regarding this?
Actually, there are several scenarios. Some scenarios, the best option is, or the best scenario would be to have a strong and long-term relationship between the Nile Basin countries as a whole, and Ethiopia especially, and Sudan. Because this is the best way, and this is not the last dam, as I mentioned, that will be built. So it's better to have
here is with the bilateral size relationship of the dam. It's a very huge dam.
Reservoir.
Yes, this is one thing, and as I mentioned in several meetings before, that there are always solutions. And the issue, or whenever you have a challenge, you have an opportunity to think and find out solutions. If we are not able to find solution, it would be our mistake. Our mistake, I mean, the regional mistake. Because it is not of the benefit of Ethiopia, or either Ethiopia or Egypt, to corner each other. And I have mentioned this to top of Ethiopian officials several times. Because if we are cornered, or we find that our back is to the wall, we should find some way out to find solutions. So it is better for them and for us. Ethiopia is a big country, Egypt is a big country, and every one of them have a role in its region. for stability, for regional stability and peacekeeping. And this is very important for Africa. Mm-hmm. And both sides should consider that. And I do believe that Ethiopians are aware of that. Mm-hmm. And if they will not come up with some solutions with us, moderate solutions, because every solution will be a cost, will have a cost, mm-hmm. on both sides. So this is a negotiation to come up to the optimal solutions that make everyone win-win mm-hmm. solutions. Mm-hmm. And this is what we are thinking, or what we are seeking. Mm-hmm. For these negotiations or these discussions, it should not only be on the Renaissance Dam, mm-hmm. but we should find out some other framework to plan, and so as not to face this issue.
You know, at the moment, I cannot evaluate the percentage of the political and the technical issue here. I mean, the Renaissance Dam, or the problem or the crisis of the Renaissance Dam, should it be solved technically or politically? I mean, which is more? Now, which has the lion's share?
Now it is, let's say that 20% technically, 80% politically. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because it is clear now, mm-hmm. that there are missing studies, and these studies should
not
be
done.
Conducted.
Didn't
yes.
take place from
and
the very beginning.
There are impacts, clear impacts, mm-hmm. either on Sudan or in Egypt. Mm-hmm. There are socio-economic impacts.
One of the main issues that was of discussion was the time of filling the reservoir, whether it be 3 years or 5 years. I think this was a main issue. Did they reach a middle ground regarding this issue?
Still, this issue is not discussed yet. Mm-hmm. So this is brought to the studies, mm-hmm. to the international firm, to come up with the best way filling scenario so as not to affect the downstream countries. Mm-hmm. And whatever scenario will be, there will be a discussion. For example, we can say Egypt could request that let's fill the dam on 10-year basis. Mm-hmm. Ethiopia will say we will lose certain amount of generating electricity because of the delay of the filling. Mm-hmm. Then Egypt would say, okay, we'll pay you the difference. This is one way. Mm-hmm. On the other side, Ethiopia will fill the dam. They will claim that we'll fill the dam in 3 years. This will impact yeah. the levels of High Aswan Dam and mm-hmm. will reduce mm-hmm. the production of electricity. This mm-hmm. is one impact. Mm-hmm. But there are other
One of
impacts.
The suggested solutions was reaching a middle ground and filling the reservoir in 5 years' time?
We cannot claim that because it depends whether you are on high flood time or on yeah. a drought time. Mm-hmm. If it is in drought time, it will be different. Mm-hmm. Maybe we would request to fill it in 10 years. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But if it is in high flood time, I think the issue will be lower.
The site which is going to do its homework well, and the more skillful negotiators are going to win this case. But let me take you to another issue, sir, as it's not the Ethiopians. I mean, here, the international community may say, oh, the Egyptians already are not that much wise in using their water, or there is no reasonable consumption of our water resources. And in the latest meeting between President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi and Minister of Water Resources, Dr. Hossein Medin al-Mughazi, as far as I know, among the issues discussed in this meeting was the project implemented by the ministry using new methods and new techniques for reasonable consumption of water and to guarantee the best usage of Egyptian water resources. Your evaluation, sir.
Yes, I'd like to mention just quickly our water resources first. We rely on our water resources about on the Nile for about 97% of our water resources come from the Nile. Mm-hmm. So this is for us, shows how vital is the Nile for us. Mm-hmm. Egypt is the driest country in the world. So our other resources are limited. I mean the groundwater, even the groundwater source is from the Nile. It is recharged from the Nile. Mm-hmm. And we have the rainfall on the north coast. This is limited amount of rainfall. Concerning our way of using or our efficiency of using the Nile water resources, we recycle the Nile water 2 to 3 times mm-hmm. because our water needs are about 80 billion cubic meter. Mm-hmm. And in this amount, this is what we use internally. But to have a full food security, we need more. And this is the difference between if we plant or cultivate the land to compensate or replace what we import from outside. We import about $10 billion. If you change it or convert it to water, it is another $20 billion. So we are talking about 100 billion cubic meter. So how do we fill this gap between what we have, the 55.5,
and
the
80?
And the 80 billion that we are consuming now, right now. We recycle the water 2 to 3 times, and in the future we will reach 6 and 7 times. This is one thing that we need to focus on our media, because it is misused. Whatever we drain is the polluted water that is used several times, and there is no way to retreat it again or reuse it again. So even the water that we transfer to the new mega projects are mixed water between drained water and Nile water. So as to maximize or to optimize the return and fulfill our water gap. This is one thing that we need to focus and to make it clear. Concerning what the minister have presented to the president, it is some other ways. I mean, as we noticed over the past months, that there was the issue of flash floods. Flash floods is a certain amount of rain that happens in a short time, but makes some
and should be used
damage. Yes, but
instead of being a source of damage, it should be used.
But this is one impact of the climate change, and it is not. It was not only in Egypt, but it is in the whole region. If you notice, in Saudi Arabia, in Jordan, in Palestine, in the neighboring countries, all the neighboring countries, they face the same issue. Even in India, yesterday there was a flash flood that affected
It was
many people
damaging,
in
and
the same,
it lasted till the moment for 4 to 5 days.
Yes, so it is a new phenomena. It may be repeated several times, and this is the impact of climate change. You will witness very severe droughts and very extreme floods, high floods or flash floods. That happens, maybe a flood that would happen in 100 years' time would repeat several times, and it will be damaging. So the challenge is how to optimize or to make our infrastructure able to absorb this amount of water and make use of it. And this is actually what I believe, that what is presented to the president. What are the needed resources to prepare this infrastructure to accommodate this amount of water and use it for the benefit of the country.
Right, sir, some experts are concerned about the possible collapse of the dam after construction, of course. And this, of course, would lead to catastrophic consequences on Egypt and Sudan. How far do you think this could take place?
I would say that it is, you know, in designing dams, you put some probabilities. And it is one of the probabilities, and this one of the worries of the Sudanese on the negotiation, that during the negotiation, that they were worried about the dam safety. And this is one option. In case collapse, it would eliminate Sudan.
And this is very strange, that the Sudanese stance from negotiations is not very positive. I mean, they are taking a neutral stance more.
Let's say that this is a difficult question, but it worth also mentioning why is the Sudanese situation like that. Sudan has receives electricity. There is a power interconnection between Ethiopia and Sudan. So Ethiopia managed to do some strong
They are going to have electricity approximately for free.
Ethiopia,
but the border, they will be the most harmed if
this possibility happens.
But this possibility, let's be frank, it is there, but it is very low. The probability is very low. And also, as far as I know, that the Sudanese have mentioned that to the Ethiopians, and they have considered it in the construction. I'm not sure, because I didn't see it myself, but I'm not sure whether it is implemented or not. But this was one of the issues that the Sudanese were worried about it. So dam safety was a measure for them. So there are very strong economic ties between Ethiopia and Sudan. There are monthly meeting between Ethiopian and Sudanese officials. Ethiopian tribes are using major part, let's say not say occupying, but using major big areas of the on the Sudanese-Ethiopian border in Sudan and cultivating it. Mm-hmm. And there are existing communities in Sudan. Ethiopia has a role in South North Sudan issues, mm-hmm. in resolving these issues. All this, interaction or interference mm-hmm. between Ethiopia and Sudan makes Sudan a little bit showing that they are neutral. Mm-hmm. What we need to do here in Egypt, actually, yes. we need to have stronger, more stronger relations between mm-hmm. Egypt and Sudan and Ethiopia. Mm-hmm. We need to yeah. to do some okay,
then
measures.
To echo what you have just said, sir, just in 1 minute, because unfortunately we're running out of time. How do you see the return of Egypt to the Black Continent in general to strengthen our position regarding this? I mean, we are back to the Black Continent after years of negligence. How yes, do you see this return concerning this Renaissance land issue?
Let me mention one thing that I have witnessed myself. I was working in Ethiopia in 2006. Mm-hmm. During that time, the number of Egyptians in Ethiopia, including the Egyptian embassy staff and their families, we were, all of us, 70. Mm-hmm. This is very low.
Sure.
In a country like Ethiopia, we should be 70,000 mm-hmm. there. The same applies to the rest of Africa. Mm-hmm. Imagine that the importance of Ethiopia to Egypt, and this are the number of Egyptians. Now, the number of companies, Egyptian companies working in Ethiopia are many. Mm-hmm. In addition, many Egyptian investors are working in Africa. Mm-hmm. What we need, actually, from the media here to make focus. For example, Kigali mm-hmm. in Rwanda mm-hmm. this year have won the best city in the world mm-hmm. because of... So if we focus, have some programs here in the media, making some focus mm-hmm. on the African cities, the impression that Egyptians are taking that you will face diseases, it is poor countries, they don't have development, they don't have job opportunities. Now if we need to go to Angola, you need to get a very strong visa, and it's very difficult mm-hmm. to get it. These are information that we need to spread among all Egyptians and the youngest, that they need to go there, the future is there.
Mm-hmm. Right. Of course, the Renaissance Dam issue is a very important issue, and the Nile water is a very important file. We'll be following up with this. And thank you very much, Dr. Mohamed Abdel Aati, former chairman of the Nile water sector. Many thanks for joining us, sir.
Right. After the short break, we're going to be back with the remaining part of the breakfast show. So stay tuned only on Nile TV International.